the Compassion's Integrated Web Teleconference and Insider Ministry Briefing. My name is Mark Hanlon, and I'm the Senior Vice President for Compassion's U.S. Sponsor and Donor Development. Before we get too far into this call, I'd like to open us up with a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you so much for your goodness to us and the opportunity to share about the needs of children around the world as it relates to malaria. Lord, I thank you for all of the people that have joined us. I just pray, Lord, that you would be honored and glorified in this presentation, Lord, and that as we discuss this issue, you might lead us and guide us into our responses to this significant need around the world. We commit this time to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, I want to thank you today, our listeners, for being with us and for taking the time to learn about Compassion's Malaria Intervention Program. Joining me today is Dr. Scott Todd, Director of Special Operations here at Compassion.
Hello, Mark, and I'd like to also extend my welcome to our listeners today. We're very grateful that you've taken the time to be with us.
I'll officially introduce Scott in just a couple minutes, but before we begin, I'd like to take care of a few housekeeping matters, and then I need to introduce a special guest that we have for you today. First, let me encourage your listeners to ask questions at any point throughout the web seminar using the WebEx Q&A tool. Very quickly, I'll provide some brief instructions on how to do that. To ask a question, click the question mark button located on the floating toolbar in the bottom right of your screen, and this will open the Q&A panel. Next, type your question in the rectangular space at the bottom and click the send button. Be sure to click the send button. Your questions will not be viewable by other attendees, as time allows, they will be addressed at the end of the presentation. Also, if you're experiencing any technical difficulties with the WebEx session today, I have a phone number and an email address for you to contact. So get a pencil and write down these phone numbers and this website. If you have any problems at all, you can dial 1-866-229-3239 for technical assistance, or problems can be addressed immediately by emailing support@webex.com. That's support@webex.com. During the presentation, all participants will be in a listen-only mode. And now we're ready to begin. But before we introduce Scott and have him dive into his presentation, it's my pleasure to welcome to our event Christian music artist Rebecca St. James. Rebecca has been a passionate spokesperson for Compassion for more than a decade. Her work has led to the sponsorship of more than 30,000 kids around the world through Compassion. Once again, in January 2008, Rebecca was named Favorite Female Artist by Christian music listeners and readers of CCM Magazine, and that's for the seventh consecutive year. She's a Grammy Award winner, a multiple Dove Award winner. She is an in-demand national speaker, a best-selling author of six books, and she has two new releases that are coming out this year in 2008. And Rebecca, I'm so thankful that you were able to join us today, and just wanted to ask you, could you take a few moments and just share with us about how you have become so passionate about Compassion's ministry, and specifically now our work together to fight malaria?
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mark, for that very lovely intro, and I'm actually calling into the panel from Dubuque, Iowa. I'm on the tour bus in the back, and I'm surrounded by Compassion boxes of sponsor packets. So, it's a real awesome privilege to be able to partner with Compassion. I love this ministry. I grew up in Australia and heard, it's kind of a household name, really, Compassion. For me, growing up in a Christian family, and then when I started singing at 16, 17, I had an opportunity to go on my first Compassion trip, and I've since been to now four different countries, Ecuador, India, Kenya, and Rwanda, gotten to meet a couple of my sponsored children, and it's just been extraordinary for me to be able to, in my concerts every night, stand up and say, this is a ministry that is filled with integrity. It's the real deal. I've been to these countries. I've seen God using it to change the world, to stop the cycle of poverty. And, I've seen it myself. And so to partner with Compassion and really have it as a extended arm of my own ministry is just so fantastic. And when I was a little girl growing up in Australia, that's really what I wanted to do. It was one of my big dreams, was to work with children in need. So Compassion allows me to actually fulfill one of my childhood dreams. The whole malaria project, it obviously is an overflow of my heart to impact the world's children. But also, it was incredibly shocking to me to find out how big of a need it is for us to help eradicate malaria. You know, malaria, growing up in Australia and now, living half of my life in the U.S., it's not anything. I mean, malaria is kind of this word that you've heard maybe once or twice, but nothing that actually factors into our everyday lives because we don't have to deal with it. It has been eradicated in the country in which we live. And so when I found out that more children are dying per year through malaria than HIV/AIDS, I mean, that was absolutely shocking to me. And every time I say that statistic, it's shocking to the people that I share it with. And so I think most people have no idea that there is such a need. And so I'm so thankful to be able to, partner with you guys, the Compassion team, in really getting this message out that we can get involved. We can be a part of, stopping this, eradicating malaria. And there is very specific ways in which we can do that. And so leading up to this day, World Malaria Day, I've been actually talking quite a lot in different interviews about how people can get involved and encouraging them to go to the website and really give money to this and to pray and to really actually create awareness within families and within churches. And so I'm just excited about, what's happening today, that we are getting this word out and really letting people know how they can actively be involved. So thanks, Mark, for letting me share.
Oh, absolutely. And Rebecca, as you've been talking, we've been showing pictures of you on your recent trips, especially in Rwanda and with your sponsored boy Sam, and we can obviously see the passion in your face, and it just comes from your heart about this issue and issues of children in general. So thank you. And for all of our listeners, if you want to know more about what Rebecca is doing in general and on her tours and in her conferences and her books and all and with Compassion, you can go to rsjames.com and see all about Rebecca's activities. So thank you, Rebecca, and we'll look forward to hearing from you a little bit later as we have a couple of opportunities to have some questions and answers come up.
Thanks,
Mark. At this time, we're going to bring up our first set of polling questions. This is a great way for you to interact and to join in on this WebEx session. And so on our first poll, we have three questions, and you'll have an opportunity to let us know what you think about malaria. Just so you know, no one's individual answers will be revealed, but rather we're going to talk about the response percentages and discuss the possible answers. So our first questions are, number one, what is the leading cause of childhood death among children? A, waterborne disease, such as diarrhea. B, AIDS. C, malaria. D, vaccine-preventable deaths, and this would include all of the following, such as mumps, measles, rubella, diphtheria, smallpox, and polio. So go ahead and click on one of those radio buttons. On the second question, where do the majority of malaria deaths occur today? In India, Middle or South America, Africa, or North America? You can make your choice there on one of those. And then the third question here is, of the 1 million people who died of malaria last year, what percent were children? A, 10%, B, 40%, C, 65%, or D, 90%. So go ahead and make your choices, and please be sure to hit submit so that we can get your input on that. And while you're going ahead and filling that out, I would really like to introduce now our featured speaker today, Dr. Scott Todd. Scott has joined Compassion in 2003. He has a degree, a PhD in immunology from the University of California. He is a Stanford Fellow. and in oncology, and is a National Lymphoma Foundation scholar. Scott has published in numerous peer-reviewed medical journals and different articles, and he is the inventor for a patent for the treatment of hepatitis C. So, Scott, let's take a look at those answers, and I'd like to hear what you have to say about this whole issue of malaria.
Thanks, Mark, and again, it is great to be here with you today. We may wait just a few seconds to see the results of the poll. Many people look at that that first question, and as well, Rebecca kind of revealed some insight as she shared with us. But looking at those causes, folks look at answer D there and see vaccine preventable. Well, things like measles, mumps, and rubella, we've pretty well dealt with that, right? But it surprises people to know that measles alone killed over 400,000 children last year. And yes, we've had a vaccine for measles for many years. Many people have also heard so much about AIDS that they might assume that it is the leading cause of death among children. And it is a major cause of preventable childhood death, with about 330,000 children dying last year. But malaria killed nearly three times that number. Malaria killed 900,000 children last year. But on this list, the leading cause of death is A, diarrhea. 1.7 million children died last year from diarrhea caused by unsafe drinking water. And as we look at the results from our poll, you see that obviously many people expected to be malaria as our leading cause. And in some ways, it's a bit of a trick question because waterborne illness is actually a mix of different diseases. You have many different viruses and bacteria and parasites that would be in that group. So if you were looking at it as a single infectious agent, then yes, malaria would be that leading cause of death on this list. Number two there, where do the majority of the cases of malaria occur? And you see that our listeners are very astute. They have 90% answering Africa, and that's correct. And then of the number of million who died last year, 90% of them were children. So we need to ask then, what is the cause of malaria? And I'd like to start by saying that we will be talking about malaria as a parasite that's transmitted by mosquitoes, and that might make it sound like a medical problem, which it is, but really malaria is caused by poverty. This is truly a disease of poverty. It afflicts the poor who live in poorly constructed homes, and they have little protection against mosquitoes. And this photo shows a typical environment of a malaria-prone community. And the story begins in the water. So as you see this photo of stagnant water in that community, most of these communities would have some kind of a swampy area around them or standing water, stagnant water in the area. And somewhere near that community in that stagnant water, there's a breeding ground for mosquitoes. Here you see a mosquito that's emerging from its watery birth. The first thing this mosquito needs to do is feed. And now at this point, this is an annoying insect, and certainly none of us would mind if God were to rid the world of all mosquitoes. But a bite from this newborn bug is not going to cause malaria because she is not carrying the malaria parasite. This mosquito could fly all over the United States, in theory, if she could, and bite thousands and thousands of people, but her chances of picking up the malaria parasite and transmitting it to someone else are just about zero. But in places where malaria is so common, in a community where it is malaria endemic, that mosquito's first blood meal offers a very high probability that the person she's biting will be infected with the malaria parasite. The parasite's called Plasmodium. So when she drinks blood, she's not only drinking blood, but with it she sucks up the parasites living in that blood. In that event, has transformed her from an annoying insect into a vehicle of death. In this photo, you will see the mosquito drilling into the skin, and in the purple-colored circle, I don't know if you can make that out, but those purple discs are actual malaria parasites. This is a photograph taken with a microscope. Now, maybe I should pause here, because I bet some of you are wondering why I'm referring to the mosquito as a she or a her. I know that doesn't seem very gender-sensitive, but there's a reason. Did you know there are over 3,000 different species of mosquito? 3,000 different species. That's pretty amazing. I bet all of us at some point in our lives have been bitten by a mosquito. And so stopping mosquitoes in some places can seem just about impossible. maybe you're thinking about those swarms of annoying insects and wondering how realistic is this to stop all those mosquitoes. But did you know that of those 3,000 different species of mosquito, there's really just one variety that's the real culprit here? It's called the Anopheles mosquito, and it's the Anopheles mosquito that transmits malaria. And it's actually not all Anopheles mosquitoes, it's only the female. And that's why I'm saying her and she. It's the female mosquito that transmits the parasite. And she only bites at night. So it's a terrorist that bites at night. Now this is what happens after she bites. This diagram shows the insect there landing on the shoulder. And as a result of that event, she may introduce a dozen or so parasites into the victim's blood. Those parasites very quickly find their way to the liver, a trip that takes about 30 seconds. And one parasite infecting one liver cell will produce about 30 to 40,000 progeny. That's parasite offspring. The infected liver cell finally explodes, and that releases those tens of thousands of daughter parasites into the blood. At that point, the parasites infect the red blood cells, and they continue to replicate, destroying the red blood cells. So the red blood cells are the ones that carry oxygen and nutrients throughout the body. And when they're destroyed like this, that's called anemia. And that's when the symptoms really begin. The symptoms of malaria, which start about 2 weeks after a bite typically, are evidence that your body is teeming with parasites. Your red blood cells are being destroyed. The debris from that battle is clogging up your kidneys. Some of those parasites might even get into your brain. You get fevers and with classic symptoms of night sweats, chills, and fevers. You feel fatigue, dizziness, pain, headache. You can have vomiting and mild diarrhea. And those are the kinds of complications that can eventually lead to death. Now, we're sitting here talking about this as if it's a textbook thing, but we are very fortunate to have with us someone who is not only an expert in this professionally as a registered nurse, but also expert personally. Emily Kagiri is with us. She is the Ministry Director of the Child Survival Program, registered nurse, a native Kenyan. She studied at the Kenya School of Nursing and joined Compassion in 2003, having previously worked at World Vision, Doctors Without Borders, International Christian Aid, and with the Kenya Ministry of Health. Now, Emily, you grew up in Kenya. You know malaria. You've lived these realities. You shared with me earlier that your first patient years ago died of malaria. So tell us, what does malaria look like?
Thank you, Scott, for asking me this question, because it's something that I have lived in. I have grown up in a malaria zone environment, and to us, malaria kind of became so normal because mosquitoes were part of our living. It was part of us, and as we grew up at night, we could hit ourselves in the practice of killing mosquitoes and the tiny insects that bite us at night. Malaria is really devastating, especially for children. I do remember at one point, I actually spoke in a friend of mine's child's funeral, and the child was about 18 months old, and the mother was a very good friend of mine, and when the baby got sick, we really did not know what was happening to the child. We took the child to the hospital and nothing much happened. Okay, the child went through treatment, nothing much happened, and the child passed away. And we knew at the end that the child passed away of malaria. And it's really heartbreaking to attend a funeral of a small baby, a funeral whereby you see people carrying a tiny little coffin, and the mom behind dressed up in black clothes, grieving her little baby, and you are followed by a whole village that is going to bury a little baby. And you are walking slowly to a small grave that has been dug by the family, and you are putting in this little small coffin. And you are throwing that on top of this little small coffin. And the villagers at the back are asking, what happened to this child? and people respond. The baby died of malaria. It's heartbreaking. It's really devastating to hear a child, a small baby, has died of malaria, which is so easily preventable, God. It's so easily preventable. And it is so encouraging to see compassion intensively raising funds and educating people about how we can prevent malaria. It's so easy to prevent, God. And I thank God that we are able to do this. I really thank God that I am part and parcel of this, something that I have seen, something that I have grown up in, something that I know, even through my profession, that actually we can prevent it.
Thank you, Emily. That is, it's so clear where your passion is from and the heart that you have, and we're just grateful to God that He's called us, called you to serve alongside of us here at Compassion. The mosquitoes are literally stealing our children, aren't they? And they're descending on the innocent in the night and injecting them with death, and they're leaving a trail of agonized mothers weeping at the senseless loss of their future hopes. As you look at this woman with her child, imagine that this is you. This is your child. I mean, if a thief broke into your home and stole your money, you'd be angry. If a kidnapper broke into your home and stole your child, you would not rest until she was safely back in your arms. For this woman, she lives with the possibility that an insect could do far worse. And you know, Jesus got angry about some things. What does it take to get a Christian angry these days? If this doesn't make you angry, then you might check your pulse, because this is not something that we should have to live with. This isn't what our world should have to tolerate. But maybe you're wondering, what can we really do? I mean, what can I really do? It seems pretty overwhelming. Can malaria actually be stopped? Mark, maybe now's the time to step back and take a look at our second set of polling questions.
Right, and we do have another polling question that we would love for your participation in on this, and so it'll be very similar to the first set of questions, and you can see the two polling questions there now on your screen. The first one is it possible to completely eradicate malaria? A for yes and B for no. The second question is, what is the most effective intervention for malaria? Is it insecticide-treated nets, some vaccine, spraying households with insecticide, providing treatment for those who are infected, or E, all of the above? Please make your selections, and we would love your participation. Be sure to hit submit in order to make sure that your selections are counted. And Rebecca, I know you have some thoughts on this, and what are your thoughts about the possibility of eradicating malaria?
Well, you know, the fact that, you know, like I said earlier, that, you know, I grew up in Australia and now the U.S., and that it really isn't a word that brings any fear into our lives at all. The fact that it has been completely eradicated in the countries in which we live shows that it can be eradicated. And so, you know, I love even the name of your ministry, Mark, Compassion, because that's what this is all about. It's having compassion on those who have been less fortunate. And one of the things, it was GMA week in Nashville, Tennessee this week, and one of the things that I was saying to different people as I was talking about Compassion and Malaria Day is that, you know, we are called to be Jesus' hands and feet, and what the world needs to see when they see us as Christians is His love in action. And what a powerful way to speak of Jesus' love by reaching out and helping eradicate malaria when, like Emily was saying, it causes such fear in the hearts of these mothers, such fear in the hearts of children. You know, I was around Wes Stafford, the president of Compassion, just recently. He's a dear friend, and he was talking about growing up in Africa as a missionary kid and seeing his little friends die of malaria, and he, in fact, himself was at one stage infected with malaria. And so he's personally been impacted by this disease. And knows that it can be eradicated, and we as compassionate Christians just need to get involved.
Absolutely, and even the root words of compassion means to enter into suffering with. And so this is just a bit of a way that we can do that as we understand that and work toward eradicating this. Scott, why don't you tell us a little bit more about the vaccine itself?
Well, there are a number of groups that are working on the vaccine, and maybe as those poll results are being drawn together and we can walk through, see the answers to that folks have submitted here. I'll tell you that the vaccine it's certainly something that we should be pursuing. We just don't have one today. And I can tell you how many vaccines exist currently for parasites like malaria. The answer is zero. We have some very effective vaccines against viruses and some against some bacteria, but malaria is different. And so while we are hopeful that a vaccine will be developed, I can see here that only 4% of our listeners selected that as the most effective intervention, possibly because one doesn't exist. But even if we are successful in developing one, it's most likely to just serve as a part of the answer. We also see 23% of our listeners answered insecticide-treated nets, which is a great answer. Spraying households, not much attention there. Providing treatment. Many people don't think of providing treatment as a prevention measure, but remember, that mosquito, in order to transmit malaria, has to bite someone who's infected, whose body is filled with those parasites. And so treating somebody actually reduces the chance of that person being bitten and then becoming a source of infection for someone else. So it does have a prevention effect. But we see here that 73% answered all of the above, and on any multiple choice test, you always pick that when you're in doubt, don't you? So good answer, that is the answer. Defeating malaria really will require multiple strategies being brought together like this, and spraying households with insecticides is actually also a part of that. And is it possible to completely eradicate malaria? 62% say yes and 38% no. We're here because we genuinely believe the answer to this is yes, even though it's so absolute, even though it sounds so complete, that word completely. We believe that this is a parasite that can be eliminated from the face of the earth. Now, I'd like to really focus on the nets, though, as an individual strategy. Hopefully I can show you this picture. What you see in this photo, little boy, you can imagine him doing his homework here underneath that white cloth. That white cloth is an insecticide-treated net. And, you know, as you look at this photo and think, well, what if this was your son doing his homework? For those of us who have kids, and I have four of them at home, it might be good to show them this picture, and next time they're complaining about their old PlayStation 2 games. But this cloth that's hanging above this little boy, at night that'll be brought down to surround him while he's sleeping, and it serves as a guardian, shielding this little boy at night. We've already had a number of questions that folks have submitted about what makes Compassion's response unique. And one of the really critical differences and uniqueness of our response is that Compassion works in partnership with local Christian churches, and that addresses the critical part of our success in our malaria response. We empower churches to minister to their community, and this photo shows you just one of our church partners as they're receiving nets. And so what you see here is that the church can serve as a distribution point for these insecticide-treated nets. But it's more than that, because the church also serves as a great venue for providing education. And you see here, you have a child underneath the net, and the net's been installed, and everybody's gathered around there to hear how does this actually work. They're learning about how to use it and how to maintain it, and also just of its importance. They're learning that it is a successful way to protect their children from malaria. But in addition to serving as a distribution point and a point of education, Compassion's partnership with local churches also allows us to equip them to walk the streets of their community and visit the homes in which people live. And that's a capacity that the local church has that even governments don't have. We equip local health workers who live in that community to walk out to the homes and make sure that the nets are being used properly. I mean, imagine this home without a net at night. The cracks in the windows or under the door, they're an easy entrance for the Anopheles mosquito. But this little girl will be under a net of protection. Now, in talking about that, you know, the logic of it is pretty obvious. Yes, if this mosquito only bites at night, and if you can protect children at night with this insecticide-treated net, then you can prevent them from becoming infected. But does it really work in practice? And that's what I'm very excited to show you, is just the results of our work in Kenya. This graph represents the percentage of cases of Compassion's children. So this represents tens of thousands of kids who are in our programs in Kenya. When they are referred to a clinic for clinical care, what is the cause of that clinical referral? And back in the summer of 2004, 80% of those cases were due to malaria. During the same time period in 2005, that number had dropped to 50%. In 2006, it had dropped to 21%, and now we are below 20%. And during that same period of time, we have distributed over 60,000 insecticide-treated nets through those local churches, and those local churches have been conducting many, many home visits to ensure that these children are protected. So here you see the results. But again, Emily, you were in Kenya during this time, weren't you? You were serving as a health specialist and then as a child survival specialist. So tell us, what did you see happening on the ground during this period of time?
One of the things that happened, Scott, was that we realized that so many children, compassion-sponsored children, were missing school, and they were also missing the compassion program events that are usually done once every week. And a number of children also were dying, and when we look into the cause of death, we realized that it was malaria most of the times. So we decided to get into it and intervene and educate people on prevention, educate the church partners and the compassion staff on prevention of malaria, and we also decided to do a large provision of treated mosquito nets. So we really focused on treated mosquito nets and also treatment and laboratory testing of our children every time they get sick. Now, it's important for us to realize that laboratory testing is either not available or too expensive for our beneficiaries to afford. So I really thank God for compassion that at that particular time, every child that got sick could not get treated without having a laboratory test to ensure that this child is actually sick of malaria, hence receives the right treatment for this for the malaria disease. And we realize that with time, the number of children who are getting treated of malaria reduced. That's why you see in our graph that in FY06, a number of them reduced. We continuously intensified the activities, and we decided to educate them on how to clean up their environments, do away with any stagnant waters where mosquito breed. And with time, as you look at FY06, it again reduced. So this is something that I know can be done because I have been part of it. I have seen it work in our country, Kenya, and I know that we can do it still in Kenya, the far that we are today, and also in other African countries.
Well, and we are so grateful for that, Emily. The work that you've done in Kenya and the many thousands of children's lives that this represents being protected because of the work of your hands. So, you know, of course, insecticide-treated nets aren't perfect, and we do occasionally still have children who fall sick. But for those children, we want to ensure effective treatment. Effective treatment using the kind of drugs that malaria is not resistant to. So health workers, again here in partnership with local churches, are trained to quickly recognize the symptoms and bring children to clinical services for appropriate medical care. In Africa now, about 80% of the kids who get malaria, this is in general, not in our compassion kids, but 80% of those kids who get malaria do not receive appropriate treatment. But with the right medicine, malaria can be treated and can be cured. So as we are wrapping up this phase, you know, I just want to say personally that I hate malaria, and I hate the poverty that allows malaria to exist, and I hate the indifference that does nothing to stop mosquitoes from stealing our children. But I'm grateful for all of you, each of you who joined us today, that you care enough to give your time in joining us and learning more, that you care enough to take action. The world needs you. The children need you. They need you to be their advocate. They need you to speak up in places of influence where their voice is not being heard. And we're not looking for heroes here. We're just looking for true followers of Christ, Christians who will live out their faith by caring for the hurting in the world. The good news is that our ranks are more than just a few. Our ranks do not number in the thousands. They number in the millions. If Christians will awaken and rally to this fight, we will become a formidable force for good, and nothing can stop the kingdom to which we belong. And no God-forsaken bug is going to stand in our way because we are on a rescue mission. And we're going to come faster than that mosquito in the night and snatch that little girl who was one of our daughters before the adversary settles upon her skin. We're going to stand in the gap for her, and we're going to stand in that gap with a net. That's what we at Compassion are called to do. And Mark, I know we've received a lot of questions already, maybe it'd be good now to take some time to look at those and answer what we can.
We have received many questions. Thank you to all of you who have participated in asking these questions. One of them that I thought we'd start out with is, what role do indigenous churches play in executing malaria-related initiatives? And Rebecca, I know that you've been out to see Compassion's work throughout the world and have seen the church in action. Do you have any thoughts on that?
I think that's actually one of the most beautiful things about Compassion is how wonderfully they partner with local churches. And I mean, it's really, instead of coming in and going, we need to Americanize this community, Compassion is equipping the local church to impact their community with the love of God in practical ways, and, you know, rescuing children from poverty. And so it's culturally relevant. It's speaking the language. It's so powerful and so strong, and the church is growing in leaps and bounds. I mean, I've spoken to pastors in Rwanda talking about how their church is now probably three times the size because of Compassion, their direct involvement with Compassion, because people are seeing the love of God in action. And so I just think that's fantastic how connected the church is to Compassion, and really, you know, Compassion can't do without the church, but the church needs Compassion too, and it's an incredible partnership.
Yeah, thank you. Scott, here's a question for you. If malaria is carried in the blood, and if you were to come in contact with infected blood, could you get malaria?
Well, if there's blood-to-blood contact, then, yeah, there'd be theoretically that risk.
Yeah.
You know, malaria in the blood would have to be at a high stage of what they call parasitemia, a high concentration of those parasites in the infected person. But, yeah, the parasite, if it was transmitted blood-to-blood, that's possible.
And tell us a little bit about the nets and how do they work, and do they give off any toxins, and is there anything there to worry about from the treatment that's on the nets?
That's a great question. The nets are very, very safe. There are several companies that produce these fabrics, and they're fantastic organizations. And the way in which they basically they embed these insecticidal compounds into the nets is only going to harm the mosquito. Even some insecticides that are kind of seen as toxic and bad, like DDT, don't harm humans, and certainly not in the doses that are effective against insects. So the nets are safe and don't pose any chemical risks of any kind. Mosquitoes actually zero in on that child while he or she is sleeping because of the carbon dioxide that the child is breathing out when they breathe. And so that carbon dioxide plume attracts the mosquito to come in. They hit the net. They hit the insecticide, and that kills the mosquito.
Yeah. Emily, maybe you would like to potentially respond to this. And Scott, you can jump in too. We have a lot of kids, our sponsor children, that live in cinder block houses. And as one of our folks say, cinder block houses are damp. Dampness breeds mosquitoes. Is there some way to address that particular issue in order to reduce the number of mosquitoes in the home?
Usually the mosquitoes breed in stagnant water, and that is one of the things that we do as we educate on prevention. We educate them that sometimes you'll enter into a home and find that they put all their clean utensils in a bucket, and that bucket drains water to the bottom, and that water will definitely breed mosquito. So we teach them and train them on how to not put have any stagnant water in their environment, whether it is on empty tins, whether it is on buckets or whatever it may be. And wherever the environment is dry, we ensure that then there is no mosquito that are breeding. So that is one of the things that we do. We educate them on how to not have any stagnant water in the environment.
Good. Yeah. Scott, anything you'd like to add to that?
Well, there are situations where homes are sprayed with insecticide, and that insecticide can last and protect for a long time. So different countries have different standards and policies on that, but where they do it, it's quite effective as well.
I've also heard about trees and bushes that are planted that also repel mosquitoes. mosquitoes. Anything you can share with us on that?
Well, it's a really interesting thing. You know, I'm kind of a skeptic sometimes, and when I saw this, I have to tell you, I was a little skeptical. But yeah, there is a particular tree, Cedrella odorata, and the colonialists years ago, I think it was in Tanzania, that they planted some of these trees around their community. And so a generation or two later, the reputation that this community was not getting malaria became known, and when they started looking for causes for that, this tree was discovered as a kind of a natural insect repelling tree. So in Tanzania, thousands of our kids have been planting these trees in their communities near their homes. And again, we didn't have it on our malaria intervention strategies of what's the most effective thing, but you could easily add that to the list. There are creative solutions like that, and I think they will contribute to the fight.
How long are the nets good for? Are they going to? How long are they effective?
That's also a great question. In the past, the nets have needed to be treated periodically, and we've been moving now toward what are called long-lasting insecticide-treated nets. Those are actually manufactured with the insecticide embedded in the fabric in such a way that it will last for 3 years in the field. Some of these companies are planning 5 years, but for the cost of them to buy them every 2-3 years is not really a problem for us. So yeah, they should be good. And now they also part of that education that happens at the church is in maintaining the net, making sure that it's used properly, doesn't get tears in it, that it's tucked in well, things like that.
Mm-hmm. All right, absolutely. The question that kind of is, I think, resonating amongst many of our listeners today, it keeps coming up, is this is an everyday occurrence. Why? And this has been going on for years. Why? Why is it just not being addressed and being addressed just now?
I think one of the things that we need to realize is that Africa is in the tropics, and in the tropics is like rain all the year round. And also the issue of governance, the issue of poverty, the fact that even a treated mosquito net, affordability is an issue. As I said there before, when I was growing up, any family or anywhere where we would see or hear a mosquito net, we knew that is a rich person. So for that poor person, even the idea of a mosquito net cannot even come into your mind because, number one, you can't even afford it. So you will live with mosquito and in your life and malaria all around. And the other thing is that treatment, again, the malaria treatment is sometimes not affordable. Sometimes it's too far. It's not even accessible. It may be affordable but not accessible. It may be accessible and affordable, but it does not work. Mm. So some of these things all around, you realize that we will live long for a while with mosquito, with the malaria parasite with us, until a time when we intensify and educate people on prevention and, of course, provide nets to those families that cannot afford nets. Mm.
Scott, do you have something else we can add?
Yeah, well, there's another perspective from history that if you look at what happened in the United States back in the 50s and 60s, we had malaria here. Mm-hmm. And during that time, it was a very, you know, post-World War II can-do spirit. We dedicated effort and resources and committed ourselves to eradicating malaria from the United States and Europe. And that's when the use of DDT came in, and there were a lot of things that eliminated malaria from the U.S. and Europe. And I think some people argue that eliminating malaria from the U.S. and Europe is the worst thing that could have happened for Africa.
Mm-hmm.
Because once it wasn't a problem in our part of the world, we lost the will to keep pursuing its demise elsewhere in the world. We nearly succeeded in India, but
mm-hmm.
You know, we greatly reduced the amount of malaria in India back 40 years ago. But a couple of things happened. We don't have time to go into all the history, but basically the banning of DDT, even though it was not banned for use against malaria in small concentrations, made DDT unavailable, and it was no longer really our problem, and we sort of lost our willpower on the thing.
Mm.
And that allowed for decades more of suffering and death. So we are awakening now to the reality that we live in a global world, and these are all of our you know, when one of us suffers, we all suffer. So those national identities might be changing in such a way that we're more willing to engage in this fight again.
Mm-hmm.
Once infected, and if not treated, how long before malaria kills? Can you survive malaria? Well, you absolutely can survive malaria. That's a very, very important point. There are about 500 million cases of malaria infection every year. And that's something we probably should have mentioned earlier, that only 1 million people died of the 500 million who were infected. That's kind of an important thing to remember, because that's why that mosquito can bite someone who's infected and move on and transmit it to an uninfected child. Now, the children in particular are the ones who die because they have not yet built any immunity to it. Without that immunity, death can come very quickly. As far as how fast, there's really not one answer. For some children who might be weakened by other circumstances, maybe they already have HIV, or they're malnourished, or there's other factors that have weakened them, they can die very quickly. There's actually different strains of Plasmodium. Remember, I said the parasite is called Plasmodium, but there's not just one. There are several. And there's a particular variety that's the most lethal. It's called falciparum. And so it can progress very, very quickly, especially for children.
And the treatment then that occurs for a child or an adult that has malaria, what is that then?
Well, still the most commonly used drug out there is chloroquine. And it's actually, back to trees, we talked about trees as repelling mosquitoes. The original compound was discovered in a tree in South America. It was quinine, and then it became synthesized and called chloroquine. And unfortunately now, most malaria is resistant to that drug, even though it's still being widely used. So we are now, there's another compound discovered in a tree, this one in China, and it's artemisinin. And there are new drugs now available that are combination therapies, so it's an artemisinin-based drug plus a couple of other things as a cocktail that greatly reduces the chance of malaria acquiring resistance to the treatment, and that is now the recommended treatment in Africa. So we're encouraging, trying to support getting what's called ACT, A-C-T, artemisinin combination therapy for kids.
Tell us a little bit about how the nets are actually kind of delivered to the church. Do we just have those delivered? Do they come? Does the church buy them? Tell us a little bit about that process.
There are various ways of doing this. Once we receive the funds as compassion sends the funds to the field offices where we have compassion working in. And from there, we sometimes send the funds to the church partners, and the church partners purchase mosquito nets themselves. However, we have some church partners who are way far from anywhere they can access mosquito nets. So the field office, compassion field office, assists in purchasing the treated mosquito nets, and they transport them to the church partner. Once at the church partner, we have staff at the church who ensure that they know each and every home of a child sponsored by Compassion. And they distribute these mosquito nets to each child. And therefore, from there, every child, the families are taught on how to spread out the net, because sometimes some children sleep literally on the floor. So how do you spread out a net without a bed?
Right.
So the staff come in and they educate and teach the families how to spread out such a mosquito net in such an environment. And from there they keep monitoring on whether this mosquito net is in use or not in use. That's
right.
How it gets to the child.
And a lot of our listeners are asking about, well, you know, does the net only go to the sponsor child? But you say it goes to the family, and it's very common in our Compassion families for whether a child is registered in the Compassion program or not to share with the family and the whole family to benefit from even one child being in the Compassion program. Is that true?
As an African child, I'd like to say that we don't have a bed for each child in our home. We share.
Like, I remember when I was growing up, we used to sleep three of us in one bed. Two of us on one side and one on the other end. So if we are three of us sharing this one net that has been provided to my sister, who is a beneficiary in the compassion program, then we all benefit. So one net will be shared by a number of the children, because one bed is shared by a number of children.
Yeah, absolutely. And some of you are asking about what is the cost of one net. And basically for one net in our compassion program, it's $10. And that covers not only the cost of the net, but obviously the education and the training to use the net and any prevention as well as treatment that might come if the child happened to be infected. So $10 can buy an awful lot of protection, prevention, and treatment in our Compassion's Malaria Intervention Program. Well, it is getting close to the top of the hour, and we're going to need to wrap up our time. Scott, any last thoughts? What kind of encouragement or call to action would you give to our listeners today?
Well, I'll repeat what I said earlier in the program, that this is a disease that we can beat. I don't have any doubt in my mind that we can beat this. There are technologies available to us already. We don't have to even wait for a vaccine. And I firmly believe that as we're speaking here primarily to Christians, that the opportunity we have to intervene and to protect these kids from getting this disease, to save lives literally, to save people from suffering, is a fantastic opportunity to live as Jesus taught us to live, the model that he gave us. He was a healer, and we need to follow in his example by bringing healing and protecting children.
We have far more questions than we have time to answer, and I want to let everybody know that we will answer all of your questions, even the ones that you sent in ahead of time when you registered, as well as the ones that have come in during our presentation today. They will be posted, and I'll give you a little bit more information on that before we close out our time today. But I do want to thank each of our panelists today, Scott, Emily, Rebecca. Thank you for your insight to this important initiative and for your commitment to serving the Lord and children around the world here at Compassion.
Thank you, Mark. It's been great to be with you.
We want to thank you, our listeners. We know that your time is very valuable. We thank God for your commitment to Compassion and your interest in learning more about how we are partnering with churches around the world to bring God's love to these children and their families. Many of you have been asking, okay, we're convinced. How can I get involved? What can I do? And we will be giving you a little bit more information on that. And in response to all of your questions, we have recorded the session today, and we'll be posting this early next week on Compassion's new blog site, which can be found at the address that you see there on your screen, or will be coming up on your screen shortly. So you can get this presentation and hear it again. Many of you have been asking about the PowerPoint presentation as well, and you should be able to get that from there, as well as all of the questions that came in and answers to those questions. Certainly, if you'd like more information about Compassion's Malaria Intervention Program, please go to www.compassion.com, and we have ways there that you can get involved immediately, whether you're an individual, whether you're a group. Some of you have been asking, how can my church get involved? How can my community group get involved in this extremely important program? And we would love to give you as much information as we can. Go to compassion.com. Or if you'd like to speak with somebody, please feel free to call us at 1-800-336-7676. And so if you want to talk to somebody about that, we will have somebody available to take your calls and give you some very specific direction on how you as an individual, as a group, as a church, as a community can participate. Thank you all, and God bless you. We really appreciate your time, and we will work together to fight against malaria and eradicate it from this world. Thank you.